Open up your Bibles to the Gospel of Mark. Here we go. Gospel of Mark, the third chapter. I'm just going to read the verses that I'm teaching on, all right, at the time. So we're going to start with the first six verses of the Gospel of Mark, chapter 3. Another time he went into the synagogue, and a man with a shriveled hand was there. Some of them were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, so they watched him closely to see if he would heal him on the Sabbath. Jesus said to the man with the shriveled hand, "Stand up in front of everyone." Then Jesus asked them, "Which is lawful on the Sabbath to do, good or to do evil, to save life or to kill?" But they remained silent. He looked around at them in anger and deeply distressed at their stubborn hearts. And he said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." He stretched it out, and his hand was completely restored. Then the Pharisees went out and began to plot with the Herodians on how they might kill Jesus. Father, come and guide us this morning. Give us insight into your word in your precious name. If you're following in your outline, the Pharisees missed the point of the Sabbath and true ministry. Once again, they missed the point of the Sabbath and true ministry. Your second point, the Sabbath is a time for man to rest and worship. It's a time for man to rest and to worship. Go back to Genesis with me for a moment. And it says, in 6 days, the Lord created everything on this earth. Created man, created woman, created the animals, set the oceans, put boundaries, the universes. And then it says, on the seventh day, he rested. We are to become like God. So, man works 6 days, and then he's supposed to take a rest, a Sabbath rest. It's not just the time to take a rest and kick back in your easy chair, which I'll do this afternoon, and relax. It's also a time to worship God. The problem with our nation is everybody's kicking back in their easy chair, wondering what's on television today, wonder if the barbecue's done yet, wondering, you know, if the beer's turned cold, wondering. But they're not worshiping God. God created this day. He set this in order so that man would take time to worship God and to remember his Creator. The attack is much worse than what I've told you already, because they're trying to tell you, you don't have a Creator. You just happened. Now, you cannot convince me of that. I went to the fair yesterday with one of my little grandsons. He's just a little over a year old, and they took him through all of the buildings with all of the animals. And that little boy was having a ball. He was amazed at God's creation. And he would just make loud noises when a rabbit would touch his finger. And the world's trying to tell you there's no Creator and that you don't have to listen to God's word and you don't have to know. But you know what? The world is wrong. And people are crashing and burning because they do not, number one, worship God and recognize God, and they do not rest. It's my prayer this morning. It's my prayer this morning that you would understand that God knows what he's talking about when he said, take a Sabbath rest, worship me. It's kind of like this. I can't keep my Harley running without my service manual. I look in that service manual. I see what I'm getting into. You can keep it running. You can fix it. Your service manual, church, is right here. The engineer, the Creator that built you, wrote this manual for you so that you can stay healthy and you can live victoriously. If you don't have one, we'll give you one. Wear it out, I'll give you another one. But go after it. Learn from him. The Sabbath was imposed by God upon soil to help feed people. I don't want to dwell on this, but if you take land and if you set it aside every 7 years and you let it rest for a year, you won't believe what you'll raise in that piece of ground next year. I tried it out. Experientially, I know it from farming, and it works because God knows what he's doing and he wants to feed you. Now, here's the point. I hope you have been watching and keeping your eye on me. The main point here is the Pharisees missed the point of true ministry. Standing in front of a church is somebody that's ill. They're hurt. Their hand is shriveled. And the Pharisees completely missed the point that there was somebody there that needed help. And all they could think of is Jesus going to heal this guy on the Sabbath or isn't he? They're after the Son of God to kill him. And yet they have a sheep in front that's hurt and they don't even think about him. Dear Lord, deliver pastors today from falling into that. I pray for every one of my colleagues in the pulpit today that they minister to the hurting sheep. It's why the prophet said to the leaders of Israel, you guys have been feeding off the sheep instead of caring for the sheep. Church, we need to care for the hurt and for the lost. Your next point, in the eyes of the Pharisees, it is unlawful to speak on the Sabbath. I wonder if you saw that when you read through that. I mean, get a picture of what happened here. You got a guy with a shriveled hand. He's standing up in front of the people. Jesus says to him, stand up. Everybody's watching. Will he heal on the Sabbath? You see, you can only walk so far on the Sabbath. You can only lift so much on the Sabbath. You can't do this on the Sabbath. The thing is, they're all talking on the Sabbath, and all Jesus does, he doesn't lift anything, he doesn't walk anywhere, he doesn't go any place to do anything to break the Sabbath. Jesus kept the law perfectly, and he just said to the guy, stand up and reach out your hand. And it says his hand was made well. I hope you noticed Jesus didn't break a sweat and he didn't grunt. He wasn't running uphill. His hand was made well. Jesus didn't break the Sabbath. Jesus was worshiping his Father on this day, doing his works. That's why the scripture, when they come after Jesus over and over for this, he says, my Father's at work and I am at work as well. Please catch the point here. The Sabbath is so you rest and you worship and you're recharged and so you can be healthy. But hear what Jesus said. He said, is it lawful to give life on the Sabbath or to take life? Can I do good or can I do good? Aren't his questions awesome? Next point, deadly enmity between Jesus and the Jewish leaders is growing. This has to happen so that they'll take Jesus to the cross. But the point is, it's building. Now, what I want you to see is when the enemy's involved and he causes enmity someplace, if you really sit back and look at it like we just sat back and looked at it, it seems so foolish that they would accuse Jesus of anything wrong for what he did. Think about your life when you're misled. When you stop and you turn around and you look back at it, you go, how foolish it was for me to stray from God. See, the enemy is full of foolish ideas. He may be trying to put some in your head right now. Don't listen to him. Run to God. Don't let the enmity get between you and your God, between you and your Father in heaven. Verses 7 through 11. Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the lake, and a large crowd from Galilee followed. And when they heard all he was doing, many people came to him from Judea, Jerusalem, Idumea, and the regions across the Jordan and around Tyre and Sidon. And because of the crowd, he told his disciples to have a small boat ready for him to keep the people from crowding him. For he had healed many so that those with diseases were pushing forward to touch him. Whenever the evil spirits saw him, they fell down before him and they cried out, "You are the Son of God." But he gave them strict orders not to tell who he was. Here's the point in those verses. Anointing from God draws a crowd. We keep praying for God to fill up the sanctuary. Especially on Saturday nights. Man, invite people. Make sure when people say, "Oh, I can't go to church. You know, I got to work on Sunday." Say, "Try Saturday night." Go after them. Bring them in. But instead of praying that I would become a good preacher so that everybody flocks here, pray for the anointing of God to be in our service. If God anoints it, people will come. Every Sunday morning on my way here, I ride all over the countryside and I say, "Lord, wake them up. Kick them out of bed. Put it in their head to go to church." There will be people here this morning. They're going to walk in the sanctuary second service. They go, "I don't know what I'm doing here, but I came." By the end of the service, they'll know God will take care of them. Remember that. If it's an anointing from God, it can draw a crowd. Jesus was totally anointed by God. Listen to the words of Gamaliel in Acts chapter 5 when they had John and Peter on the trial. Man, they had them up on the stand there because they healed somebody in the name of Jesus. And they said, "Don't you ever talk in that name again." I dare you to go through the Acts of the Apostles and highlight every place they tell them, "Don't speak that name. Don't teach in that name. Don't do anything in the name of Jesus." And you should highlight it and do the opposite of what they tell you. Speak the name of Jesus at all times. Listen to the wise teacher Gamaliel. "Therefore, in the present case, I advise you, leave these men alone. Let them go. For if their purpose or activity is of human origin, it will fail. But if it is from God, you will not be able to stop these men. You will only find yourselves fighting against God." The scribes and the Pharisees were fighting against God to try to stop Jesus and the work of his Father. It's why Jesus says the gates of hell will not prevail against God's kingdom. Church, it is my prayer that you are joining God in the work that he is doing. Make sure you're not on the wrong side, on the opposite side of him, because you will lose. But I believe God's anointed you to go out. The next point, verses 13 through 19. Jesus went up on a mountainside and called to him those he wanted, and they came to him. He appointed 12, designating them apostles, that they might be with him and that he might send them out to preach and to have authority to drive out demons. These are the 12 he appointed: Simon, whom he gave the name Peter, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. To them he gave the name Boanerges, which means sons of thunder. I love those guys. Andrew, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James, son of Alphaeus, Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, I can't wait to meet him, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. Now here's the point. God, good leaders train up and empower disciples and delegate ministry to them. Good leaders like Jesus, he trained up 12 men. He spent 3 years with them. He gave them authority. See what it says in the text. He gave them authority to heal people and to cast out demons, and Jesus sent them out. Good leaders will train people up to do what they do. That's exactly what Jesus trained these men to do, and then they will delegate to them. Now listen closely, church. I give you permission to go out and be witnesses for Jesus today. Represent Mount Zion Christian Church. Represent the body of Christ. If you're from another church, go out and invite people to meet Jesus. Don't hold back. Go get them. You're all looking at me like, is he serious? Yes. Go out and be a witness. I went to a country music concert at the fair last night. You can always learn something in country. Listen to this. I know that this person, that Winona Judd did not originate this, but this is what she said. She said, my mom taught me, suit up, show up, and a miracle will happen. You know what the problem with the church is? We got people, they're not suiting up and showing up and expecting anything. Church, you serve the God of the universe. The same Jesus that sent these men out is sending you out. You have the power of the gospel. Don't be ashamed of it. Don't be afraid to speak. Don't be afraid to love somebody unconditionally. Don't be afraid to help someone. You'll find the anointing from God. And it will make things happen. Verses 20 and 21. Then Jesus entered a house, and again a crowd gathered, so that he and his disciples were not even able to eat. And when his family heard about this, they went to take charge of him, for they said, he's out of his mind. My family said the same thing about me. And the teachers of the law who came down from Jerusalem said, he's possessed. Church, listen very carefully to this. His family is not convinced that Jesus is authentic. They're just not convinced. It's not about you. It's not about me. It's about Jesus. If they come against you, they're coming against him. His family was not convinced, okay? Verses 22 through 30. This is such an important part of the text this morning. The teachers of the law who came down from Jerusalem said, he is possessed by Beelzebub, by the prince of demons. He is driving out demons. So Jesus called them and spoke to them in parables. How can Satan drive out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan opposes himself and is divided, he cannot stand. His end has come. In fact, no one can enter a strong man's house and carry off his possessions unless he first ties up the strong man. Then he can rob his house. I tell you the truth, all the sins and blasphemies of men will be forgiven. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. He is guilty of an eternal sin. Now look at the verse. He said this because they were saying he has an evil spirit. Blasphemy of the Holy Spirit is attributing the works of Jesus to the devil. People get so confused about this. I was so confused about this when I got saved. I thought because I cussed all the time and I cursed in the name of Jesus, I had committed the unpardonable sin. That's not what the scripture says. The scripture says in verse 30, he said this because they were saying he has an evil spirit. Think of who he is. He is Jesus. Church, they had Jesus in their midst, in person, working miracles, healing the shriveled hand, casting out the demons, cleansing the leper. And the scribes and the Pharisees said, he is using the power of the devil to do these good things. That is a blasphemy against the work of the Spirit of God. In all honesty, because Jesus is not here in person with you, he's here by the power of his Spirit, you can't even commit the sin they're talking about here in person in the exact same way. However, you can resist God. Your next point, failure to recognize the power of the Holy Spirit working in Jesus is unpardonable. Please listen carefully. Refusing to recognize Jesus as the Son of God and the works that he does is something that Jesus can't get around, and he won't let it go because you won't do the one thing you have to do is fall on your knees and humble yourself before a mighty God and accept his forgiveness. The world today goes crazy over choices and over rights. Church, God has given you the most awesome gift. He has given you the free agency of man. And you have to use it. You must use the gift God has given you to submit to him, to bow your knee to him, to humble yourself before a mighty God. If you don't, God is still there with his hand out. He's ready to forgive. The work is done, but you must take his hand. You must accept his forgiveness. You must accept it. The scribes and the Pharisees in the text would not accept it. They would not even acknowledge that Jesus was God or came from God. They said, "You are from the devil." And Jesus said, I believe he wept when he said, every sin man commits can be forgiven, every blasphemy. But when you go against the Spirit of God like that, the office of the Spirit of God is to reveal the true identity of Jesus to you. It's why 1 Corinthians says, no man can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit holds the spotlight on Jesus so you and I can see him for who he is. And when you say no, Jesus waits patiently for you to come. And the enemy twists this and he tries to make people think there's no hope for them, and it's absolutely wrong. There is hope for every sinner on the face of the earth with Christ. If they're still breathing, there's hope. I have been to nursing homes and I have seen people wake out of comas to accept Jesus, fall asleep, and pass into eternity. People have said to me they have not been awake for more than 3 weeks. You walked in the room, they sat up, they prayed the sinner's prayer with you. I just don't get it. And I said, I get it. There's an amazing God with amazing power. Unity in the church renders the devil powerless. Did you see it? He said, hey, if you got a strong man, you can't steal his stuff unless you tie him up. And you can't be divided. You can't fight amongst yourselves. So Jesus says, if devil's divided against the devil and his house is divided, he's going to crash. Isn't his logic just amazing with these guys? Let's catch it here, church. Let's get unified. Let's quit arguing amongst ourselves. Let's quit fighting with other churches. You know what pastors talk about when we get together? There are so many unchurched people in Walworth County that if our churches were all filled, do you know there are still enough people to build new churches and just fill them? There are that many churches that are people that do not go to church in our county. We could fill all of our churches right now, and there are still people that can't get in the door. But we need to unify. We need to come together. Somebody comes talking to you against somebody in the body of Christ. Kneel down and pray with them that they can forgive and there can be unity so that we can wipe the enemy out and live victoriously. It's quiet, isn't it? Lord, bring healing. Next point, unbelief and disunity allow the thief to steal, kill, and utterly destroy. John chapter 10, verse 10, the thief has come to steal, kill, and to utterly destroy. And he does that by making people upset with each other and doing what the Pharisees did, totally missing the point of ministry. To where churches aren't about helping somebody or healing or ministering or giving the love of Christ. They're just trying to keep their doors open and get the next project built. And it all misses the point. And Jesus says, you guys, get together, stay together, be unified. Let my power flow through you. Bind the devil and wipe him out. Every time you obey Jesus, you beat the devil. Did you ever think about that? Every time you obey your Lord and Savior, you beat the enemy at his game. His game is to get you to go against your God. I'm so excited, I can't stand it. Isn't the gospel awesome? Come together and win. Verses 31 through 35. Then Jesus' mother and brothers arrived standing outside. They sent someone in to call him. A crowd was sitting around him and they told him, "Your mother and brothers are outside looking for you." "Who are my mother and my brothers?" he asked. And then he looked at those seated in a circle around him and he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and my mother." Here's the point. Jesus is family with those that obey his heavenly Father. Here's what it doesn't mean. It does not mean that Jesus does not love his family. Let's get that out of the way, all right? Let me prove to you. On Jesus' worst day, hanging on the cross in excruciating pain, he looked down from the cross and he said, "Mother, behold thy son. Son, behold thy mother." He kept the fourth commandment and he loved his mother. So don't let any false teachers tell you that Jesus did not love his family. James became the head of the church in Jerusalem after Jesus rose from the dead. What Jesus is doing here, what the Spirit of God wants to do, is to say to every person that's listening to this message, you can be part of the family of God. Are you? And Jesus says, if you do the will of my dad, then you are my brother and you are my sister. Here you are. How many people here know Romans 8:28? Yeah, whole bunch of you know Romans 8:28. Anybody know Romans 8:29? I love that verse. Romans 8:29. A guy that knows the whole book by heart just raised his hand. Praise the Lord. Verse 29. "For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers." Do you understand, church, what family you are part of? Do you recognize whose name you carry? I went to the fair yesterday and I had my brother's name on my back. It said Christ. Is there any resemblance? The way you live your life, is it like Jesus lived his life? Here's my prayer, church. First and foremost, as we end this service this morning, Pastor Steve, I'd like to ask you and Lisa to come up here. Dan, you and Kay, come up. If you're in here this morning and you are not part of the family, you don't know that you belong to Jesus Christ, come up and speak to us this morning. Come up and ask for prayer. If you're part of the family and you've been acting like you're not part of the family, come up and ask God for forgiveness. If you're confused and you don't know what you need to do, come up here and ask for help. Ask God for help. Most of all, take the gift God has given you, that free agency, and submit to Jesus with all your heart and do exactly what the Spirit of God calls you to do. Father, we come in the precious name of Jesus. Lord, you know the heart of every person listening. Father, come in Jesus' name to guide us and to direct us. Lord, be with us as we leave this place today. Jesus called 12. He called a lot of people in this service today to go out and take the authority that he's given us to be ministers of the gospel. Lord Jesus, help us to see that it is the hope of this nation. It is the hope of Walworth County. Guide us and direct us now, Father. Send us out to do your bidding. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Amen. If you need prayer, like I said, please come up. If you have questions, come up. If not, you're free to go out and be part of Jesus' family. Amen.